happy to be with you these few moments. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are going to, before we get to Romans, I'm going to ask some questions. And I just want you to answer aloud, or you can answer to yourself. The first question is, are you happy to be saved?
Yes.
Lord have mercy.
Yes.
The question has been ringing for the last week.
Yes.
You know, some of us have been saved so long that we are desensitized to the status. Yes. Hallelujah. Are you still glad to be saved? I'm going to move this back. Are you still glad to be saved? Last night, I was
in the house
just watching, you know, YouTube, and I tend to get into gospel music, and they keep suggesting it, sermons, and they keep suggesting. And somebody just asked the question, or they just said, I'm happy to be saved, and tears just came out of my eyes. Mm. Just the mere fact that I can say I have a hope, a hope that does not stop, a hope that does not diminish. I'm so glad that I have salvation. This is just simple one-on-one faith. I'm just so happy that when I walk out of my house, if something was to happen to me, I know where I'm going.
Yes.
Yes.
I find comfort in that. I don't know if you find comfort in that, but I find comfort in knowing that God has a plan.
Lord,
I am so at peace in my spirit that come what may, I already know that the deal is sealed. Mm. My God, hallelujah. Does that help you get out of the bed in the morning? Mm-hmm. And does that help anybody to know that whatever comes my way on any day, my heart is fixed and my mind is made up? You couldn't sell me another belief system. You couldn't pay me to be something else.
Right.
Are you still glad that you're saved? My Lord. Every time I say it, I feel power. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. I'm just so glad to be saved.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Now we're going to ask the next question. Do you have, or have you ever had doubts about your salvation?
Mm-hmm.
Lord have mercy, Jesus.
Yes.
Lord,
yes.
Setting us up. I'm setting us up for next week. I'm not trying to get in your business or spill your tea. I'm just asking, at any point in your spiritual journey, have you or do you ever have doubts about your salvation? Lord, have
you?
Yes.
Hallelujah. It's okay to say yes. I must say, I have had doubts.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I mean, Lord, how could you? Lord, have mercy. Okay. Let me just tell you why I ask you that question. Many of you have read my call to ministry statement. Many of you have read my call to ministry statement that are here in this call, in this time together, this fellowship, which is publicly available. If you want the link, I can give it to you. Within that document, I reference the significance of Romans 8, 28. Mm-hmm. If anybody's ever read my ministry statement, Romans 8, 28 is baked in there. This passage of scripture is the cornerstone of my conviction. It's the cornerstone of my conviction. And what do I mean by conviction? Conviction means that I have a strong belief that this is a compelling consciousness of my faith. So I have to ask you, I'm telling you about, you know, my stuff. Do you still have a conviction? And if you do, what is your conviction? What is where the rubber meets the road for you when it comes to your relationship with God? Mm. Where, if something happens in life and you need to leverage what you believe, the skid marks in the road, where is your conviction at?
Yes.
This is a location in your spirit, in your relationship that you have to think on. As we go and come every day, we need to know why it matters. Hallelujah. For me, it's Romans 8 and 28. We'll get into the scripture in a minute. What is your conviction? Some people, when they say, I'm so glad I'm saved, they break down because they think about what the Lord has delivered them from. They think about how far they've come in the Lord and how the Lord has transformed them. What gets your engines turning in the Word of God? What scripture? What circumstance that God showed himself mighty in your life? What is that story? What is that moment? Because I want you to draw from that as we move forward in time. I want to be able to ask you, what's your testimony? and you should give me a powerful statement of belief. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Let me just tell you a little bit about mine. At or around the age of 17, that was when I decided to step out of childhood and into maturity. And I'm talking socially as well as spiritually. I found myself all at once. I found myself all at once leveraging the knowledge that had been imparted to me for my very survival. Now, some of us have knowledge because we make money off of it. Mm-hmm. Some of us have knowledge because it makes us look smart on social media. But have you ever had to leverage knowledge in order to survive? Lord. Mm. Have you ever had to know the word of God to get you out of a situation?
Yes.
Lord, have mercy, Jesus. I don't know how far we're going to get tonight. We only got 30 more minutes. But we are going in now because y'all about to be graduates. Hallelujah. Yes, we have to have Jesus. Some grown-up conversations about this thing we call our faith.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Have you ever had to say Jesus like your life depended on it?
Yes.
Yes, Lord. Jesus. Yes.
Hallelujah. Jesus. I don't know whether it was a car accident. Yes. Hallelujah. I don't know whether it was a toxic relationship. God. Hallelujah. I don't know whether it was the doctor's report. Have you ever had to say Jesus?
Jesus.
Your life depended on it.
Yes.
I'm telling you guys, I was 17 years old.
Jesus.
And I had to reach down in my spirit and move from Sunday school to real life. Hallelujah. I know what I'm talking about because I lived it. Hallelujah. When somebody calls you and tells you that where you used to live got shot up.
My God.
Jesus.
And you still.
Jesus.
You still got to go to school. You still got to go to work. I didn't even know what PTSD was in 2002. All I knew was that God had told me something and I moved in obedience. And if I had been disobedient, I would have been killed. Mm. 17 years old.
Jesus.
Stepped out of childhood and into spiritual maturity. I, in that moment, in that season, because I had turned, by the time the shooting happened, my birthday was the same weekend. I would have never made it to 18. Lord have mercy. That season was when I moved from a cultural Christian. You know, I grew up in the Bible Belt, church Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. But it was at that moment where I changed from being culturally Christian or God adjacent into a consecrated God dependent.
Yes.
Thank you,
Jesus. I'm gonna just let that breathe.
That was good.
Can you remember when you switched from God adjacent to God dependent? My God, my God. In these life-altering moments is where our conviction or our convictions are forged. I want to submit, perhaps, if you've lived long enough, you have several convictions. There's a lot of things that have happened that only God could have gotten you out of.
Yes.
My Lord.
Where are your convictions tonight? Have they been forged in the fire of life experience and divine intervention?
Yes.
Hallelujah. When you don't have anywhere to go but up. Hallelujah. When your back is up against the wall so hard that you might just bust through the other side.
Yes.
Lord have mercy.
Thank you, God. Thank
when you fall, your favorite five, and nobody answers the phone.
Ooh.
Woo! Anybody been there? You calling folks to give you a word, to give you resources, and nobody. This is where you find your conviction. This is the place where the hand of God reaches down into the hell hole you found yourself in.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe even the hell hole you created.
Mm.
I know I created a few. and he pulls us out. We like to say the muck and the mire. But this time, it hits different. Lord, how can I serve you? I'm a willing worker, a vessel ready to be used. Hallelujah. Many of us hesitate or feel doubt when we are asked the question if we're saved. Many of us, we hesitate. Somebody asks, you saved? And we in our spirit be like, I don't know. Or they ask you straight in the eye, are you going to heaven when you die? And we kind of not sure, you know, like, I think I'm going. I'm striving to get there. I'm coming up on the rough side of the mountain, doing my best to make it in. You know, you've heard that before. That's because we have allowed Pharisees and Sadducees to put our salvation on a performance improvement plan. Lord, have mercy, Jesus. Now, I think I can close my laptop right here. Lord, have mercy. Maybe even some of you here, have allowed Sadducees and Pharisees and other religious zealots to put our salvation on a PIP. Now, somebody doesn't know what a PIP is, so I have the definition here, if I can see it. A performance improvement plan, or a PIP, is when an employer gives a deficient performing employee an opportunity to succeed. Hallelujah. That's when it's a tool by HR that they give a low performing employee an opportunity, a last shot to keep their job. We, as believers, as joint heirs with Jesus, have somehow, along the way, allowed people to put a measuring stick up against our salvation. Lord have mercy, Jesus. I'm only on the second bullet point, so we may have to end early tonight. Hallelujah. But I'm just wanting to whet your appetite tonight. This is just an appetizer. Hallelujah. This is just your miso soup. Hallelujah. That's all it is. We're not going to take you out tonight because I got so much more, hallelujah, that the Holy Spirit has already downloaded. But we've allowed ourselves to be put into spaces and places and churches and denominations and clubs and organizations that make us feel that we're not deserving of God's grace. Now, we don't deserve it, but I don't need you telling me that. I don't need you telling me that. Hallelujah. Many of us have been bamboozled by religious zealots and people who either don't have the Holy Ghost or are trying to control us into believing that their metrics of manipulation, control, and religious experience somehow determine our eternal destination. Woo! Now, in the spirit, I think I smell smoke. I smell smoke because some people might be burning their rule books right now. Woo! Lord have mercy. I smell it. Hallelujah. Burn your rule book. Hallelujah. Burn it. Let me say this. Those who come to Christ as their Savior enter into eternal relationship with God that guarantees their eternal security. That's right. So tonight we're moving from providence into a sub-doctrine of eternal security. Hallelujah. Now we will have the reading of God's word. Hallelujah. I just wanted to set this up. We may not get very far, but I'm hopeful because we have a great reader in DIT Antoine. Hallelujah. I'm going to pause there for a minute. And the scriptures are on the screen for your edification. Is everybody with me? Is anybody lost? All right. DIT Antoine, you can read verse 28.
Thank you, Pastor. Here beginneth the reading of God's word. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. We thank God for the reading of the word on tonight. So we are convinced that every detail of our lives is continually being woven together for our good. This is what the scripture is saying. God is continuously weaving every finite detail of our lives harmoniously. Hallelujah. For we are his lovers. Hallelujah. Who have been called to fulfill his designed purpose. Somebody said purpose by design. Hallelujah. You have been purposed by design. Hallelujah. So in the Greek, the word called means, or it's pronounced kletos. Kletos is the word. It's kletos, which means to be invited by God to obtain salvation in the kingdom of God through Christ. So that means that you have been invited to the party. The question is, why are we acting like we are uninvited guests? You have been invited to the party. We are convinced, the scripture says, we are convinced that every detail of our lives is being woven together masterfully by God. Hallelujah. His eternal purpose. The last word in that scripture is purpose. In the Greek, it's prothesis. Prothesis, which means his intent. His intent. So in the womb of God's eternal purpose, we find four principles. You could write this down if you like, because I'm almost done. In the womb, I like to use that word because womb means there is going to be a birthing. In the womb of God's eternal purpose are four principles that I hope that we will touch on in this series. The first one is foreknowledge. Foreknowledge, that's one word. Somebody can put it in the chat. Foreknowledge is the first principle. The second principle is predestination. These are all words that we're going to pull from these three scriptures. You already see some of them on the screen. We have foreknowledge. We have predestination. We have justification. And we have glorification. These are the three principles that we will extract from these three scriptures. Hallelujah. D.I.T. Antoine, verse 29. Oh, you're on mute. You're on mute.
My apologies. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren.
Thank you. For he knew all about us before we were born and destined us, sealing us with his mark. Hallelujah. He sealed us with his mark from the beginning to share in the likeness of his son. This means the son is the oldest among a vast family of brothers and sisters who will become just like him. Whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. First among many brethren, to foreknow in the Greek. Prognosko is the word in the Greek, to have knowledge beforehand of those whom God elected to salvation. I'm just building this so that when we go in the next time, you will know what I'm talking about. To foreknow, to have knowledge beforehand of those whom God elected to salvation. I have to ask the question just for the hearers. Are you glad to be saved?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes. I'm telling you, when I read this today, it just sent a surge through my body because I know that God in his purpose elected me to be saved. He chose me to have salvation, the gift of salvation, something we can't even afford, let alone strive to work for. We can't even earn it. He gave us salvation to predestinate in the Greek. I'm going to try to say it. It's proorizo. Proorizo in the Greek means to decide beforehand. God decreed something before eternity or from eternity. He decreed that you and I will have salvation from eternity. That's probably going over a lot of our heads. Just, you know, we're looking at the clock and saying, Lord, it's 41 after. I said that the Lord God ordained or foreknew, he predestinated us from eternity. Ooh, Lord have mercy.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
My God. I'm just trying to let it sink in. Let me just say this to help it make more sense. God lives in eternity. We live in time. God lives in eternity. We live in time. Eternity, there is no clock. One day is like 1,000 years. 1,000,000 years is like one day. Time is irrelevant in eternity. So when God said, I'm going to send D.I.T. Antoine into the earth, he said it from eternity. It manifested in the 1980s. The book of Jeremiah says, before you were even formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. Your spirit lives and is native to the heavenlies. You are a spiritual being having an earthly experience.
Yes.
Come on with it now. Yes.
God knew
God.
That you would love him before he even gave you a body.
Jesus.
Glory, glory, glory.
Jesus. My God.
It almost brings me to tears, y'all. He knew that you would love him.
Yes, God.
Before he even gave you your first breath. God divinely appointed us from eternity to represent him on earth. That's why we always say, I am on assignment. You are on assignment because you were sent here. Your spirit was put into this body for you to give him glory. That's why we say we were created for worship. He gave you an assignment in eternity. Call now. My question is, what are you doing with the commission? Woo! Lord have mercy. I don't want to get ahead of myself. We just want to cruise on to the end of 30 and we'll come back next week because this right here is hitting some people's lives for the first time. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. To foreknow, he knew he had foreknowledge. He elected us. I can just see myself in the heavenlies, raising my hand and saying, Lord, send me, I'll go. Send me, I will go. My God, he decided beforehand, decreed from eternity, and then we will be conformed. Conformed, sumarphos in the Greek, conformed, having the same form as Jesus, fashioned like him. This is why he sent us here, to take on the image of our big brother Jesus, who is the first of many brothers and sisters.
Yes.
My God, we should be going through the process now of our face, of our vibe, of our energy, of our motives, aligning with Jesus.
My Lord.
Amen, amen.
Our discipleship, our evangelistic mandate, our commission begins when we become a son or daughter with this new image. So your evangelistic campaign began the day you said yes to the Lord.
Yes.
Verse number 30, we're closing out.
Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified.
My God.
Amen.
My God.
Amen.
My God.
Amen.
We're going to close out on 30, y'all. We got to come back to this because somebody needs a to-go box. Hallelujah. They're full and they need the white styrofoam with the sections so they can eat off of this for the next week. Hallelujah. Mm. Having determined our destiny ahead of time, he called us to himself and transferred his perfect righteousness to everyone he called. And those who possess his perfect righteousness, he co-glorifies with Jesus. Lord have mercy. I want you to know that you have equity in eternity.
Jesus.
Woo! You have equity. You have skin in the game about what happens next. My God, hallelujah.
Thank you
have
Jesus.
Ownership. You have a vested interest in Jesus cracking the sky. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
I want to know, do you still believe in the rapture? Hallelujah. Yes. Do you
Thank
still
Jesus.
Believe
Jesus.
In the rapture? Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Justified.
Thank you, Jesus.
Justified. What does that mean? We have been justified through Christ Jesus. What does that mean? It means to declare or pronounce one to be just. It's a declaration that because of Jesus shedding his blood on Calvary, not guilty. It's a judicial act in eternity. It's a judicial mandate that because of the atoning blood of Jesus Christ, you're not guilty for eternity.
Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
To declare or pronounce one to be just, righteous, in the King James Version, it says freed, or we like to use the word emancipated. Hallelujah. Free from slavery.
Amen.
Slavery of sin and death and hell in the grave. Hallelujah. And then the last word is glorified. Glorified. And the word in the Greek is pronounced doxazo. Doxazo in the Greek means full of glory, completely conformed to the image of Jesus. So in the end, we will be glorified. That is the whole purpose of God. His eternal purpose is for the glory of Christ to reign and have rule and dominion over the earth. So why is Paul writing this as I close? Why did he write this? Let's bring it home. Why did he write this? It's Romans 8. Romans is a book written to the Christians in Rome during some of the most difficult times for early believers, the early church. You all remember from last week what they were going through in the book of Hebrews?
Mm-hmm.
Well, they were going through it just the same in the book of Romans. It was illegal to be a Christian. In fact, if you were Jewish, you were accepted. That was a legal religion. It was a legal religion, A as in legal, but Christianity was illegal. But Paul is writing to us in 28 through 30, a trifecta of encouragement to the Romans that I hope encourages you and me tonight. I hope it encourages you. Paul is writing, one, about the future adoption of our bodies at the coming of the Lord to give the Romans and now us as believers hope and strength. The adoption of our bodies in perilous times. I don't know whether anybody in here is going through any type of pain in their bodies. Whether you may be dealing with COVID, post-COVID symptoms. Somebody that you know might be on a ventilator. I want you to read to them or to yourself Romans 8, 28 through 30. Because we know that these earthly bodies, these mortal bodies will be glorified in the future. Mm-hmm. Just the mere fact that it won't be like this always.
Yes, God.
Get up and put on my best face and clothes and function. It will always be like this because this body is going to be glorified when Jesus comes back.
Yes.
That's enough just to get me out of bed in the morning. That I won't always feel this heavy, this lethargic, this overwhelmed, because the Lord is going to quicken my body.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Now, for some, that might not be a pep rally for you, but like it is for me. So let's move to the second point. And I'm closing. Our present ability to persevere through hardships and challenges is aided by the Holy Ghost.
Mm. Yes.
Woo! Lord have mercy. If you couldn't scream on number one, if you have the Holy Ghost, you could make it.
Yes.
Hallelujah, God.
Because he empowers us to kingdom service.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I can do all things through Christ.
Yes.
Who gives me strength. Hallelujah. And he's powering you through the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. So if you can't get happy about the future, about the apocalypse, about being delivered from this world with your future glorified body, get happy that you have the Holy Ghost. I'm so glad I'm saved.
Yes.
My God. He gives me the strength to face all conditions.
Yes, God. Like,
Don't need a battery. He doesn't need somebody to give him a pep talk. He doesn't have bad days. He's not like us. He doesn't get in his bag when things go his way. Holy Spirit is there to comfort and keep and guide and hold us.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
You've got the Holy Ghost. You can make it.
Jesus. Mm.
And thirdly, the trifecta, the third point that Paul is writing to encourage these Roman Christians who are being gathered up and killed for sport, turned upside down and burned. He's chained to soldiers as he writes this.
Yes.
Chained to soldiers as he writes these letters to Christians just down the road who might not come home tonight. Their families have to read the letter. Mm. Third, strength from the knowledge that God is providently working out every finite detail of our lives towards the end he already established in his eternal purpose. Hallelujah. Everything that you go through, whether it's good, bad, ugly or indifferent, God is working it out towards the end that he's already predetermined. Hallelujah. Providently working out every finite detail. Maybe you heard some bad news. Maybe you're going through tough times. That is working towards God's end. He's taking every negative report, every negative emotion, every good thing that is happening to you, every bad thing that is happening to you has been programmed to the eternal purpose of God and the Lord Jesus Christ winning in the end. Hallelujah. This is why Paul wrote the letter. So I ask you tonight as I close, are you saved?
Jesus.
And I ask again, do you have any doubts about your salvation?
Jesus.
Next week, we will go in a little deeper because I've got to prove to you now why your salvation is sealed. I've now got to go deeper, but I just wanted to whet your palate to let you know that all things are working together for your good. You are on the winning team.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, God.
You are part of the royal family.
Yes.
The Lord is not an Indian giver.
Jesus.
His words is sustaining the universe.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
the Lord is not going to divorce you. In fact, the Holy Ghost is when he put the ring on it. That might have went over your head. Hallelujah. But the Lord is coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle. What did he give the church when he ascended? He promised them the Holy Ghost. Hmm. And the Holy Ghost is the engagement ring until he comes. Mm-hmm. Woo, Jesus.
Thank God.
I'm telling you that Jesus put a ring on it. I need all of the single believers to put their hands up like this and say,
Jesus, Jesus.
Put a ring on it.
Jesus.
Hallelujah. You have been proposed to. And the Holy Ghost is just the tip of the iceberg of the glory that shall be revealed to all of us.
Thank
I want to God. Give God some glory tonight for the word. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah by the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Just put your hands up. Just put them up. Thank God that your salvation is secure. Hallelujah. That it is eternal and it is unconditional. Hallelujah. You're saved and you're saved.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
God.
Hallelujah. You're saved and you are safe.
Thank you, God.
Yes. Hallelujah. The Lord wants you. Hallelujah. Like he wanted you in eternity. Hallelujah. Still wants you. Hallelujah. There's nothing that you can do that can separate you from his love. Hallelujah. You are loved unconditionally. Uncontrollably by our God. Hallelujah.
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. You are not forsaken. Hallelujah. You are not forsaken.
Hallelujah.
You are never alone. Hallelujah. You can make it. Hallelujah. Because he's already put the down payment on you with the Holy Ghost. Just imagine the glory that's going to be revealed when we are glorified with Christ.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Are you ready to reign on tonight? Are you ready to reign with Jesus?
Thank you, God.
Hallelujah.
You, God.
Hallelujah. We just give my heart is so full. I could cry. Hallelujah.
You,
I'm so full by the promises of God. He knew you before you breathed. Hallelujah. We want to make him proud with the way we live. We want to make him proud because of the grace and the mercy that he had to give us in order to receive the gift.
Yes,
hallelujah.
Yes.
God for the salvation. Mm. Hallelujah. We thank God
thank
for
you,
that
God.
Gift.
Thank you, God.
For the grace and the mercy that causes us to stand up and be counted. Hallelujah. To God be the glory for all of the great things that he has done. At this time, I would ask that either one or both of our leaders just give us words before we transition with our ministry and giving and announcements for this week. Be blessed, everyone.
Thank you, God.
Pastor, do you want to go first?
Yeah. Truly, I've just given honor to God and trust in knowing that God is able to do all things with fear. I truly thank the Father for this message, his word on tonight. And as evangelist said, as far as about your salvation and whether you know whether or not you're saved, you know, as you know, when we think about that question, we gotta think to know. We shouldn't have to think about it. We shouldn't have to even consider it. If you know you have accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, be sure. Make your appointment sure. That you know that you are who God called you to be and doing what God has put place in your hand, your heart to do. Because truly, God is good. And I'm so elated tonight to be able to be on the Zoom with you all tonight and just hearing the word. I hear it every Thursday night, whether I'm on it or not, I still... See, I'm a silent listener. I'm listening. And I be sitting there listening to the word, and I know the word is good all the time. Not some of the time, but all the time.
But, yes.
I have to come on and show my face for exactly who I am. I think everybody already knows me, but I just thank the Father for the word tonight. And I just thank Minister Trevor, Pastor Trevor, or delivering the word. I mean, I got to get used to that because I'm used to just calling him plain old Trevor. And that was just from little, from childhood to now. We truly thank the Father for this opportunity that he have afforded us to come and to hear the word. And God is good, not some of the time, but all the time. He has brought us out of some situation that if it had not been for the Lord, he wouldn't have made it. Well, I thank you for this opportunity.
Well, praise the Lord, saints. Now, you know, I do have a few little things I would like to say. Thank you so much, Pastor, for going first. I just want to be sure that you all understand that the shooting that the minister was talking about didn't happen at our house, okay? He was away at school. I just want to let you know that. So don't go off the Zoom saying, oh, that's the matter, shooting at the house.
Oh, hallelujah.
Glory to his name. I just want to help somebody out. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
And then on a serious note, we do thank the Lord for the word, and it was so rich. So I just wanted to share just these little few little nuggets with us, and they bless me, because as the pastor was bringing the word, as evangelist was bringing the word, hallelujah, the Lord just dropped these little few things in my spirit. When he was talking about the Holy Spirit, he said about the single people and putting a ring on it and all of that just a few minutes ago, the Lord reminded me that we need to understand that the church, the body of Christ, is the bride of Christ.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be the ultimate marriage here. Hallelujah.
Yes.
This is going to be it. Hallelujah. That's why he said he's coming back for that church without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. And if you think about a bride, when she come down the aisle, she don't have no spot on her gown. She don't have no wrinkles. Honey, she's beautiful.
Yes. So
that's how God wants us to be presented. Hallelujah. To Christ. Hallelujah. And this lesson was so rich and so powerful. And even as he led us right into it, asking us, are we saved? And if we're saved, where's our conviction? I heard in the Holy Spirit, he said, we'll have conviction when we switch from playing church and be the church.
Yes, hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Somebody heard what I said. When we stop playing
church. Amen, amen.
And be the church.
Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
My God.
Amen, amen.
Yes.
Then he went on to tell me a little bit further as he was ministering. I'm talking about the Lord talking to me now. He said, then we can savor having a savior.
Wow. Jesus.
My Lord.
Savor.
Then we can savor having a savior.
Yes.
Now, I will just tell mine just real quick, and I know we got to go. As far as how I know I'm saved, is because I was under extreme spiritual warfare attack.
Glory.
That caused me to, I was going to accept God or die.
Yeah.
So as Trevor said, he missed the shooting. My.
Jesus.
I missed the trap that the devil had set.
Glory, Jesus.
To take me out once and for all.
Yes, yes.
As the sister said on last night, she's a sniper for God.
Come on.
Yes.
Once you understand, hallelujah, that hallelujah, yes, you are made for glory, to give God glory. But also, hallelujah, you are a weapon too. Don't make me walk around this table. Not only are you made to give him glory, hallelujah, hallelujah, you are a weapon of warfare.
Yes.
I'm trying to finish it up. Now back to Romans 8:28. And I love that so much because as he said, hallelujah, it just does something to us. When you know, hallelujah, what it really means.
Ooh.
to summarize it and put it in simple terms, that Romans 28 talking about all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and called according to his purpose.
Yes.
You can just say this when you get up in the morning. Nothing can happen to me today that me and God cannot handle.
Jesus, glory be to God.
Okay. Amen. Amen.
And then, and if the devil really pressing in on you, because he talked to us about power in pressure, you know, power under pressure, you can go on and say, because he lives.
Yeah.
I can face tomorrow.
Face tomorrow. Thank you.
Come on in here with me.
Yes. Glory, glory.
Thank you, Lord.
Now I'm almost done. Now, when he talked about the predestination,
Lord Jesus,
in regards to the predestination, see, some people don't like to talk about it, but I love it. God knew that you and I was going to give him a yes.
Yes, he did. He did.
He knew. He knew. He knew before you even knew, before I even knew. He knew we were going to give him a yes. Even though we were bucking up and carrying on, he knew there was a yes in my shanana.
Glory, 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 glory.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
Now, dealing with this predestination, and this is my last point, and I'm going to be quiet. When we understand about this predestination, and we understand that we are joint heirs with Jesus Christ, when he moved, I move just like that.
Ah.
Have a good night.
Glory.
Hallelujah. Amen. Why don't you go ahead and come off mute and give God some praise? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Just like that. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because it's in him.
I
move and I live and I have my being. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It should be a praise party up in here. Hallelujah. Somebody was walking around like they didn't have a ring on. Hallelujah. But the deal is still. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes, God.
The deal
is
sealed.
Glory to his name.
Time. Hallelujah.
Thank
you don't have to worry about the Lord running out on you. Hallelujah. He ain't going to come home any time of night. Hallelujah.
Yes.
He is always there.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
All you have to do is call him. Hallelujah.
Yes.
He will work it out. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We thank God once again for each and every one of you. The Spirit of the Lord is just moving even now. And if there was an organ, hallelujah, and there's one in my spirit, I don't need no music.
Glory.
Hallelujah. But I want to be civil because we're on recorded camera, hallelujah. But if I was by myself, when I get off camera, oh my God, hallelujah, hallelujah, glory to his name. We're going to move. We would ask, we're not going to ask MIT tonight, but we will have our announcements and then we will have our appeal for the offering. Just quick announcements, Bible boot campers should have their section 11 and 12 quiz turned in by, I have tomorrow, but it's day after tomorrow, Saturday, September 4th.
Yes.
No Bible boot camp on Sunday, September 5th. And Bible boot camp final examination is the following Sunday after next, Sunday, September the 11th. Hallelujah. We would ask that if you have been blessed by the word tonight, that you be so generous to give a donation, give an offering on tonight. Ministry certainly does not run off of the Holy Ghost, hallelujah, but it runs off of people with the Holy Ghost, making that deposit into the kingdom, hallelujah. We know, we believe in Luke 6:38, which is the principle of generosity, and the measure by which you give, it will be given back unto you. Give, 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 so that God can work on your behalf. The instructions are as follows. You can text the word give to the number 833-980-1492. Once again, you can text the word give, G-I-V-E, for all of those who speak French, to the number 833-980-1492. And you will certainly be taken through the prompt. You can give any amount. No amount is too small. And of course, no amount is too big because our God is infinite. But we would appreciate everything that you do on tonight in our ministry in giving. Because we have a pastor here. I just love to hear him pray. Would we have a, could we have a closing prayer tonight? By
I have announcement.
Oh, go ahead.
You didn't offer us, but if you don't mind, before he gives us that dynamic prayer, just two things. We will be having service on tomorrow night at 7:30. I will forward the Zoom information to IFC, to evangelists, and to those who may want to join us. We will have Minister Sherry Harvin from Oxford, Mississippi. She will be coming at 7:30 tomorrow evening to bring us a word from on high.
Hallelujah.
And as those of you who have heard her, she is a very anointed, very powerful woman of God. And so she will close us out. We've had three nights of service joining you all tonight. We had our spoken word last night, and tomorrow evening we will close out with another powerful word from God, because this is what we need, saints, even in a pandemic. Mm-hmm. And then lastly, I would just want to mention that Pastor and I will be celebrating our 34th wedding anniversary September 5th.
Amen.
Congratulations.
Praise the Lord.
Wow.
34, yeah.
Woo-hoo. That's awesome.
And we don't look like what we've been through.
Hallelujah.
All right.
They raised me, y'all. That's what she tried to say.
Amen.
Oh my God.
Thank you.
No problem at all. Pastor, at this time. Oh, Pastor Richard, yes. Yes.
Let us pray. Mercy and everlasting fathers, again, we come giving you thanks and giving you praise. Father, we thank you for this opportunity that you afford us to come before thy presence. And Father, as we have heard your word tonight, Father, we ask that you allow this word to sink deep within our spirit, man.
Yes.
Enrich us, to empower us, and Father, that it will help us to grow therein. Father, we ask that you let us be your servant that you have appointed us to be. Father, allow us to come and do those things that you have called us out to do. And Father, truly we understand and we know that many of us have failed. We have gone through some situation in our lives that what was not so pretty, as one could say, or were not so good. But Father, you kept us.
Yes, God.
You kept us in the midst of our storm, our stormy life that we have lived. Father, you kept us in the midst of
us.
And Father, you, at this time, you have calmed the raging seas in our lives.
Yes.
Now that we have come to this point in our life, Father, we just want to serve you. We just want to glorify your name. We just want to thank you for all that you have done for us, all that you have carried us through. And Father, not just those on the Zoom, Father, but we ask, Father, that you touch the hearts of those that are going through right now in Louisiana and New Orleans and surrounding areas, Father, has in that has suffered from a storm of nature. Mm-hmm. Father, we ask that you touch their hearts and their mind, calm their spirit.
Yes, right, Lord.
In the name of Jesus. And not only that storm, Father, but Father, for those that are going through bereavement, from, whether it be COVID or whether it be natural causes, Father, we ask that you touch the hearts of the bereavement right now, Father.
Yes.
Help them to understand, Father, death is just the beginning of life. Those that are saved and have trusted in the Lord, Father, death is just the beginning of life.
Hallelujah.
Father, we transition from one glorious life, from the life of trouble, into a life of peace and comfort with you.
Yes.
Father, we ask that you touch their hearts tonight, Father. Touch them. Father, help them to see the glory of the Lord in the land of the living. And Father, this we ask in Son Yeshua's name, and we ask that you will allow your Holy Spirit to continue to rest through and abide with us and forevermore. And all we always people said, it is so.
It is so.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, why don't you just go ahead and give God some praise? Hallelujah.
As hallelujah. We thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We have a new reason hallelujah. To celebrate. Hallelujah. Yes. Came from citizenship. Hallelujah. Yes. Albertina Walker said, I got another building not made by hand. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes. Just praise God that you've got a home in the sky. Hallelujah. Yes. When you finish your course.
Thank
glory
you.
To God. And yet I'm still saved.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Have a blessed night, everyone.
Night.
Night.
Good
night.
I have been so very low. I have had some rough times. Some people have really hurt me so. But Jesus was a friend who he was consistent in every way. When Satan tried to kill me, he came and he put him back in his place. He gave me the power to change everything in my life. And even though Satan still exists, he will never have control of my soul. I've been through some valleys.
Yes.
Satan tried to destroy me. He came and they put him back in his place. Then he gave me the power to change everything in my life. And even though Satan still exists, he'll never have control
of my soul.
God bless everyone tonight. My soul is rejoicing. My spirit is so full.
Yes,
and we can thank God for each and every one of you being here tonight. See, we don't have a whole service. I got to get up out of here with that. Lord,
goodbye.
Hallelujah. Thank you, everybody. Yes. For being